Welcome everyone to another episode of AppSec 101. My name is Andrew Garrett, and I am pleased to be joined today by Diogo Rispoli, and he is a Fortify Master Solutions Architect. And a little bit about Diogo. So he is a seasoned professional. He actually got his start as a developer, and now he has more than 10 years of experience in software security. So Diogo actually has knowledge in a variety of different areas, including AppSec testing, pen testing, DevSecOps, information security, software engineering processes, cybersecurity, and fraud prevention. You know, before joining us at Fortify, he actually worked in companies in many different market verticals, banking, insurance, telecom, consulting, and he also worked in several big companies in Brazil, where he actually had the opportunity to establish software security processes and tools. So, Diogo, I think your background speaks for itself. I'm very lucky to be speaking with you today and looking forward to hearing what you have to say.
Awesome, Andrew. I've been working with application security. And before that, I was a developer for a long time. I've been doing a lot of different things on application security. I didn't mention before, but I was for 4 years OWASP chapter leader in Brasilia, Brazil, and you know, working with customers from Latin America, Brazil, and North America in general, U.S. and Canada. I had a lot of exposure on different aspects of application security as well. Yeah.
Yeah, that's great. And, you know, we're happy not only to have your experience in AppSec, but also, you know, to bring your global perspective to things as well. So it's great to have you on board.
Awesome.
Well, let's go ahead and get started. So today we're going to be talking about attacks, specifically cross-site scripting and SQL injections. So to get started, first, let's just take a high-level overview. What is cross-site scripting? What is a SQL injection? And, you know, maybe any other type of injection attacks that you'd like to touch on today?
Yeah, it's interesting because that's the way OWASP defines the attacks right now. So that's, if you look at the OWASP top 10 list, I'd say 3 or 4 different attacks there are related with injection attacks. And injection attacks happens every time you use a certain type of command, and this command can be related to operational system, to a particular language, or a particular a type of operation your application performs, and it makes your application change the behavior it's running. So OWASP separates SQL injection and cross-site scripting, the last OWASP top 10 for web applications, as SQL injections is in the group of the injection attacks, and cross-site scripting is so important and has so many affected applications, at least at that time, because we know OWASP looks over time to compile that list. That cross-site script got, a full category of its own. So injection attacks, every time you inject any type of command, you have an issue related to injection. And when you inject that command, it navigates through the different layers of your software to change that behavior. Injection attacks are commonly related to LDAP, XML files, database commands, OS commands, and so forth, so on.
Okay, so now that we have an overview of what these attacks are, let's talk a little bit more about the importance of preventing these types of attacks. What are some of the damages that can come from that?
Yeah, so let's start with SQL injections, right? So a SQL injection attack occurs every time you can mix your user input with a SQL command that you have on the database or the data layer of your application. So that's what happens with SQL injection. In the way the attacker does those attacks, they try to search different input fields on the forms on a web application, and they try to play with that particular SQL inject syntax to make it mesh with what you have internally on your application. And the biggest issue with a SQL injection attack is you can not only, or the biggest issues we have here is not only overpass a feature or a capability an application have, and you know, a classic example is when you have a an injection attack on the logging form of an application, you can bypass the logging information or can bypass the logging process on an application. But I think the biggest issue you get with SQL injection is you can have a data breach. An attacker can play with that attack and can extract the data in the database, and now they own the data you have on your application. So that's, I would say, the biggest concern we have with SQL injection attacks. On the other hand, we have cross-site scripting, right? And cross-site scripting is when you abuse input form validation or, you know, an API method with JavaScript commands. And that JavaScript, it meshes with the source code and the JavaScript you have on your application. And that makes your application behave, again, in a different way. The biggest difference, I would say, from SQL injection and cross-site scripting, in my opinion, of course, is with SQL injections, you have, I would say, a final attack. You abuse, you know, certain features you have on your application, or you have a data breach. On cross-site scripting attacks, they are usually a bridge to a second attack or third attack. It's more used to for the attackers to collect useful information from your application, from the application you have, and based on that, they can make your application or they can make a second attack. In a classical attack, you can do combining cross-site scripting and some certain or certain types of vulnerabilities is a session replay attack, where you can steal, or an attacker can steal a session identification ID from an application and can reuse that session ID for a different attack or to use the application as a real authenticated user, and of course after that abuse their features and capabilities.
So we've talked a little bit about these types of injections, these types of attacks. Maybe Diogo, you could outline some recommendations for us on some strategies and also some best practices.
Awesome. So before I get to specifics on how to protect SQL injection or how to protect cross-site scripting, because of course you can use a very specific strategies for all of those two. One thing that we have to keep in mind when we're talking about injection attacks is using input validation. So if you look over the data that your user is inputting on your application, and you decide if that's if that information is good or bad, or contains any type of commands or reserved words from programming languages and all that good stuff, before you decide if that information is good or bad for your application. So looking over the input validation, using allow lists and block lists look at the specific data that's being inserted on those fields is very important and can help prevent not only cross-site script and SQL injection, but all sort of, injection attacks. So input validation is key to prevent those attacks. Since we don't have one only strategy to solve all those attacks, one second thing you can do, especially with SQL injection, is use parameterized queries. And to understand why using parameterized queries will help you out, you have to understand the way SQL injection is exploited. SQL injection is exploited because someone inserts a malicious payload on the input validation that contains a piece of a SQL command or a SQL syntax. And that SQL, if you're using, if you're not doing a proper input validation and you are doing some concatenation on the queries on the back end, those two information can merge together, can mesh together, and those two information will act as a different type of query that was programmed before by you or any developer, and it will change the behavior. So if you use parameterized queries, the SQL machine your language uses stops using that input validation as a command and start using that input validation as information. And it changes the way it is processed on the back end on your application and changes or reduce a lot the way the exploitation can work or can happen. So SQL injection, the easiest way to prevent this attack is using parameterized query your backend. This is the easiest way. But we know sometimes we don't have the source code. This is a legacy application. There's different ways you have to deal with. So for SQL injection in general, you can always use also tools like WAFs and the RASP tool we have, Fortify has Application Defender to prevent those sort of attacks without using or rewriting the source code. So this is SQL injection. Cross-site scripting is a little bit more challenging because cross-site scripting has a broader way to be exploited. We have three different ways to exploit cross-site scripting. One is storing the cross-site scripting command on your application in using a different page or a different layout. The second is inserting that payload that will be processed by your application and will come back on the response. And this is called a non-persistent or reflected cross-site scripting. And we also have a document object modeling or DOM-based cross-site scripting that affects more APIs and API calls. And also, there's different ways of preventing. So first of all, input validation, very important. Second is using encoding, HTML encoding, that you can change that information that's being inserted to a notation. And instead of a raw command, it will be interpreted by your HTML and your JavaScript machine as information, not as a command. And you're good to go. And also, our Application Defender as a tool, WAFs, sometimes even IPS signatures can be used to prevent all those sorts of attacks. Sometimes it's kind of complicated if you don't have enough experience to identify in your application the way those attacks are happening. So of course, use Fortify SCA static code analyzer and also a Fortify Web Inspect or dynamic application security testing tool can not only help you to identify, but also can give you some hints on how to fix and remediate those. Fortify SCA, especially SCA that looks over the source code, it will give you not only a very detailed description of the issue, but also will give you some snippets of source code that you can inspire and can use as and can lead you and can help you get the solution you need. So using Fortify, of course, will help you to identify and fix and also even prevent those attacks to happen.
Okay, yeah, and maybe just to wrap things up, attackers are always becoming more and more sophisticated. Maybe you could leave us with some thoughts on what's one way that we can stay ahead of these attacks and stay on top of them so that we're being maybe a little more proactive and not so reactive.
Yeah. So being proactive on application security is key, in my opinion. Of course, if you have access to SAS, DAST, IAS, RASP tools, you are ahead of the game. You can understand when those things happen, and you can also understand how to remediate those things quicker, and also can take track of all everything that's happening on your, secure development lifecycle, DevOps, DevSecOps or whatever, you know, environment you are working on right now, or different agile, waterfall, no matter what type of, you know, development strategy you have in place. But of course, sometimes only solving things on the source code or identifying them on the application is not enough. You can also, and I would say, a secure design for your applications is very important. So you can design frameworks or reuse frameworks from, you know, OWASP or different other sources to reduce the those attackers, hackers have to exploit those issues on your application. And of course, monitor your application in production, see what's going on, insert log information that can be useful for the monitoring process in the future, and also the REST tool, the application defender, the tool we have in Fortify can also help you with monitoring the behavior and what is happening on production, and can help you trigger that monitoring on your SIEM solutions or whatever tool you're using to monitor your applications.
Yeah, that's great. And I'm glad you brought up, you know, SAST, DAST, IAST, RASP. These are kind of the building blocks. These are the essential tools. And it sounds like what you're encouraging here is a shift left mentality. We hear shift left security, and it's all about, you know, implementing security earlier into your lifecycle, right?
Yeah, absolutely. When we're talking about shift left is making the application secure from, you know, the beginning when you're developing for the first time, because we know as far as we get to the right, and when we talk about the right, we talk about where we are deploying and running the applications in productions, more expensive is to fix an issue. And I'm only talking about the cost related to a developer spending, his or her hours fixing or remediation issues here. I'm not talking about when you have a data breach, how much money and how big will be the loss for your brand when you lose that information. So the cost we are talking about here is, you know, a developer that costs $100 per hour. How many hours he will be, spending on fixing those things. Sometimes we can get something in the order of 100 times more expensive, fix those after they get to the production, instead of doing it right and make the cost be the cost of the developing only. So of course, as far as, you know, shift you get, better for your process. Fortify has different tools. Fortify has, for example, a security system tool that can help you while you're developing, identify those things and, you know, remediate those things even before your source code is checked in on your repository. So as far as left as you can get, and that far that left can be by the usage of tools, but also by you as a developer looking for new types of, you know, knowledge to prevent those things to happen on your application. So everything works together to get, you know, a more resilient, a more safe, protected application in the end of the process.
Yeah. Well, Diogo, I think you've given us some great things to think about, some great advice for developers, and really for anyone that's involved in AppSec. And, you know, speaking of shift left, I encourage our viewers to go out and check out our Shifting DAST Left episode. I'll put the link up above here if you want to click that video and check that out. But Diogo, thanks for your time today. You know, it's been great to have you here. You've given us a lot of great advice, and I think it's important because, you know, these attacks, they're a real thing, and as you mentioned, they can be very costly to fix if you put off some of these testing that you should be doing. So to our viewers, thanks for watching this episode. If you haven't subscribed yet to Fortify Unplugged, please hit that subscribe button, like this video, and leave a comment down below. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you next time.
Bye.